गुड मॉर्निंग। सो टुडे विल जस्ट रिवाइज व्हाट वी हैव डन इन लास्ट टू लेक्चर्स। देर वाज सम इशू, आई हैड शोड यू द रिकॉर्डेड वीडियोस एंड देर मे बी सम क्वेरीज फ्रॉम योर साइड, सो आई विल क्विकली रिवाइज व्हाट वी हैव डन इन लास्ट टू लेक्चर्स। सो वी हैव सीन द टाइप्स ऑफ इंजीनियरिंग मटेरियल एंड द क्लासिफिकेशन ऑफ इंजीनियरिंग मटेरियल। ब्रॉडली इट इज क्लासिफाइड एज मेटल्स एंड नॉन मेटल्स। Then going into more details, we see that the classification is metals and alloys, polymers, composites and ceramics. So polymer, composite and ceramics fall into non-metal group, whereas metals and alloys fall into metallic group. Now going into more details further, we can find that metals can be classified into two groups. One is ferrous, that is iron containing metals, and non-ferrous, that is non-iron containing metals. Okay, similarly polymers are of three types. One is thermosetting polymer, another is thermoplastic polymer, and third one is elastomers. So these are the different materials that are used in engineering applications, and therefore they are called as engineering materials. The reason they are called as engineering materials is due to their utility and properties that are useful in engineering applications. Okay, so now composites. These are the materials which are composed of more than one material, and therefore they are called as composite. They may be metal plus non-metal, surface may be metal, inside it may be non-metal. Many a times largely composites are used as surface being non-metal like plastic, resins or wood, and internally they are reinforced by metallic strings, wires or rods to enhance certain required properties. Fiber reinforced plastics that we called FRP, carbon fiber and gray fiber, so they are called as GRP, FRP and so on. Then we have structural composites. Now structural composites are what material? One of the best example of structural composite is reinforced concrete, RCC. In our home, in slabs, in columns and beams, steel structures are there, that is steel reinforcements are there, and it is filled up with concrete so as to give compressive and tensile strength. Next is ceramics. Ceramics have a special application, special use in engineering industry. Ceramics are clay products, abrasive ceramics and glass and cemented ceramics. So these are the groups in which ceramics are used as engineering material. Based on their applications, they are called as abrasive ceramic, clay products or glass and cemented products. Okay, so this is about classification of engineering materials. Now we go into metals. What are metals? A solid material which is typically hard, shiny, malleable, fusible and ductile with good electrical and thermal conductivity. So whenever you are asked in some quiz or some questions what are typical characteristics of metal which can be identified by seeing it by audible sense, then your answer, correct answer is shiny, ductile, fusible. What can be seen? Shine can be seen. When you hit the metal with another metal, you get a typical metallic sound. That is another identification method, whether it is a metal or non-metal. So example of metals are iron, gold, silver, aluminium and alloys such as steel. Now alloy. What is an alloy? It is a mixture of more than one metals together to get better usable properties. So an alloy is a material composed of two or more metals, or a metal and a non-metal. There may be small quantity of non-metal added to the metal to enhance certain required properties. Okay, example of alloys are steel, stainless steel, aluminium, brass, bronze, etc. Okay, now coming down to detailed classification of metals and alloys, we have two groups, ferrous and non-ferrous. In ferrous group, we have steels and cast iron. Steels include carbon steel and stainless steel. Okay, and cast irons are the alloys of similar to steel, but the only thing is it has a higher percentage of carbon content, and therefore they are grouped into another product name that is called cast irons, right? Non-ferrous alloys are copper and copper alloys, nickel and nickel alloys, aluminium and aluminium alloys. Now going to more details, that is what particular material is called iron steel, what is called cast iron, how carbon alloys, aluminium alloys and nickel alloys are different, right? So non-ferrous, ferrous is a iron as a main constituent. Non-ferrous other than iron as main constituent, that means iron will not be the main constituent. Iron may be present but in a very small quantity or like a impurity. Steel has a carbon content which is less than 2%, and cast iron are the material in which the carbon content is more than 2%. So whether it is very clear, what is steel? Any material with iron as a main constituent and carbon content less than 2%. What is cast iron? Any material with iron as main constituent and carbon content greater than 2% but less than 5%. Okay, I hope the things are getting refreshed and you are understanding the things better. Copper alloys has copper as main constituent or main content, that is 70-80% copper and rest of the things as alloying elements. Aluminium, it may have 95% of aluminium and 5% of alloying elements, or more or less depending on the particular class and grade of the material. Nickel alloys, again same, nickel is the main constituent, whereas alloying elements may be ranging from 2% to 20%. Now next group of material that we had seen in the classification is polymers. What is polymers? It is the chain or the material which is connected together in the form of chains, and this is at microscopic level. So all plastics, different types of transparent, flexible, solid, malleable plastics are all called as polymers. Polymers exist in three phases. One is solid, semi-solid and liquid phase. The best example of liquid polymer is the Fevikwik that we use or the gum that we use. You all must be knowing or have used somewhere Fevikwik, Araldite, Loctite, M-Seal, all these are polymers. Okay, you have your pads, writing pads, which are made of fiber or plastic, those are also polymers. We use the polythene bags, these are also polymers. Okay, in engineering practice, all the materials are used in various applications like packing, sealing and load bearing material. Okay. Plastics or polymers are further divided into two groups, thermosetting plastics and thermoplastic polymers. What is thermoplastic? That is thermosoftening plastic. Thermoplastic means with increase or decrease in temperature, their phase changes. That is, when you heat the material, it becomes soft. When you cool it to the room temperature or below room temperature, it becomes solid with improved hardness. Thermoplastic may be reshaped by heating, and with increase in temperature, it gets softened, and cooling down, it gets solidified and hardened. Thermosetting polymers are the polymers which have chains which are cross-linked by covalent bonds. The starting materials are placed into a mold to form a desired shape, but once the shape is formed, you cannot change the shape by reheating the material. That is the difference between thermosetting and thermoplastic polymers. So thermosetting plastics will not get softened when they are heated and will not be reused for reshaping it, whereas thermoplastic polymers can be heated, softened, reshaped and reused. All our Bakelite switches, that is electrical switches, are of thermosetting polymer type. Okay, the resulting three-dimensional details are there. I am not going into detail. Examples of thermosetting polymers are epoxy resins such as coating material, clock, manufacture of insulating materials, etc. Tool handles, billiard boards, sprockets, insulations, and so on. Elastomers, the last category in polymers. Elastomers, the name suggests they are having an elastic characteristic. In this, the elastic characteristic is giving it a reusable, reshaped, inflating type of properties. Like the examples are shown in figure, will be more informative. Elastomers are used for making waterproof clothes, making gumboots, making tires inflatable. Okay, so elastomers are mixture of rubber and polymers, okay, to give it a characteristic of extension, elongation and regaining its original shape when the applied forces are removed. What are different elastomers used in industry? One is natural rubber, then you have polyurethanes, polybutadiene, elastomer material used on wheels or tires of the vehicle where wear resistance is required, neoprene as a material used for insulation and used in industrial belts, silicone material used in wide range of material and areas due to excellent thermal chemical resistance. Silicones are used in manufacture of pacifiers, medical processes, that is medical equipments which are resistant to corrosion, lubricants and molds. Then we have composites. Composites are made from two or more constituent materials with significantly different physical and chemical properties. What is the peculiarity? That two materials are used together, but their basic physical and chemical properties may not be matching with each other. They may be different. So we are using these two materials, combining them, binding them in some or the other way to get the advantage of both the material characteristics. Okay, these composites are of three different types. One is called as laminar. Okay, you are seeing the decorative sheets on the boards of different shops, malls, and everywhere. So that are aluminium plastic sheets. Aluminium is the front and plastic PVC is the back end of the sheets. These are decorative sheets used in interior decoration or used in architectural products and so on. Similarly, in engineering also such products are used as tabletops, as the tops and covers of different equipments, wherein front surface is metallic, giving good cleaning ability, good resistance to surface from water and other elements, and easy to clean, whereas plastics give the support and make it light in the weight. Also, the cost reduces. Then particle reinforcement. Reinforced composites have two types of reinforcement. One is particle reinforcement and another is fiber reinforcement. Fiber means like threads, wires, or solid rods. All are called as fibers. In case of particle reinforcement, these particles are used like we are laying the plastic sheets and we want some material that can take the compressive loads. Then we include some ceramic granules in it so that the material can take the compressive type of load. Second is reinforced fiber. We have seen very many plastic sheets used in roof sheets. They include fibers either in the form of threads or wires or directly in the form of cloth. Okay. Now last group is ceramics, and they are classified as metal oxide ceramics, nitrides, and carbides. Ceramics are defined as any organic, inorganic substance do not contain carbon or its composites. That means any inorganic non-metallic material. Okay, so alumina is aluminium oxide, zirconia is zinc oxide, zirconium oxide, glass is a silica, and glass ceramics we know everywhere. Main applications in household we have seen, but various application in industry are not known to us. So industrial applications, best application that we know is abrasive materials. Okay. Next application is in electrical industry as insulators. So these are some of the architectural engineering applications of ceramics. Now what is crystalline metal? What is the characteristic of a material? So metals are always crystalline material. Metals are also called as crystalline material because the basic component building block of metals is crystalline in shape. That is, it may be classified into certain specific geometrical forms, either cubic, either planar, either volumetric. So in planar we have face type of geometry, in cubic we have cubical geometry, and third geometry is that we have of hexagonal shape. Okay, so crystalline materials, the atoms are arranged in three-dimensional array called as lattice. Lattice are a regular repeating configuration in all direction. That means they will go on making a chain like this. So these are called as lattice, and this complete shape is a crystalline shape. If you break up one of these, crystals, then you get a specific geometry, that is we call it as a cubical geometry. They may be at right angles or at certain angle deflected. Okay, so unit cells, single atom and lattice, these are the three groups. One unit cell, when these cells are connected to each other, they form a certain shape, and when these unit cells are again formed in the material, then it is called as a lattice. Crystal structures, I think this would have been covered by Amit sir or Kuchadia sir also. I'll quickly repeat these things as to what are the three different basic building block shapes, crystalline shapes that are considered. One is body centered cubic structure, another is face centered cubic structure, and third is hexagonal closed pack structure. Okay, so face centered means, body centered means there is a atom at the center of the body and atom at the vertices of the cube. So what are the different examples? Alpha ion, molybdenum, tungsten, vanadium, titanium, chromium, sodium and potassium. These are very hard materials, difficult to draw, melt and less ductility type of material. So cast ions are having BCC structures. These examples would have been covered by Kuchadia sir, and you have some assignments in your practicals also for solving such examples. And you have face centered, that is one atom is at the center of the face. One atom is at the center of the face. What are the number of atoms in unit cell of body centered crystal? That is 8 plus 1, 9. What are the number of atoms in face centered cubic at single cell? 8 plus 6, 14. Just remember these numbers. Gamma ion, copper, aluminium, silver, gold, lead, nickel and potassium. So these materials, plutonium, these materials are malleable and ductile and easy to form. A packing factor is 4 generally for FCC. Hexagonal closed packed structure. Okay, these are the hardest material. So hexagon 6 plus 6, 12. 1 at the center, that is 1 plus 1, 2, 14. 14 plus 3 at the central faces, that is how many? 6 plus 6, 12 plus 2, 14, 14 and 3, 17. So 17 atoms form one unit cell of HCP type of closed structure. Okay, 12 plus 2 plus 3. So packing factor average value is 6. Now we go into details of the physical properties. What are the physical properties? Density of a substance, its mass per unit volume, symbol is rho. Mathematically it is expressed as rho is equal to m divided by v. More density, more dense structure, more weight will be there. Less density, less dense structure, less weight will be there. Similarly, with the increase in density, some physical characteristics or mechanical characteristics like ultimate tensile strength, hardness also increases. Next physical property is melting point. The temperature at which the material changes from solid to liquid is called melting point. Melting point of different materials are different based on its characteristics. Specific heat it is the amount of energy required to increase 1 degree centigrade of temperature for 1 unit volume of the material. Thermal expansion is the tendency of matter to change its volume in response to change in temperature due to heat transfer. Thermal conductivity, it is the property of material to conduct the heat, often denoted by K, lambda or small k. SI unit of thermal conductivity is watt per meter degree Kelvin. You have to remember these units and short definitions. They may be asked in the multiple choice question or assignment. Thermal conductivity is good in metals. Thermal conductivity is poor in polyester, alumina and non-metals. Now the important properties, that is mechanical properties, stress, strain and the product of or ratio of stress strain. So what is strain? It is a change in dimension per unit original dimension when a force is applied. That is called strain. What is stress? The force per unit area is called as stress. Unit is Newton per mm square. Strain is a unitless quantity because it is the ratio of change in original length to the change in length. Now what are some of the typical entities in reference to the material and engineering properties are strength, stiffness, elasticity and plasticity. What is strength? Ability of material to resist the externally applied force without breaking or yielding. Yielding means without increasing its length. Stiffness, it is the ability of material to resist deformation under stress. Elasticity, the property of material to regain its original shape after deformation when external forces are removed. Steel is more elastic than rubber. Do you take this? You have to take this because the testing results show it. We generally find rubber very elastic, but when experiments are made, steel has a very good elongation. The only thing is the required force is very high. Steel has a very good elongation, but the required force to deform it is very high, right? Plasticity, it is the property of a material which retains the deformation produced under load permanently. Plasticity means if you extend or if you deform a material like steel or aluminium and remove the force, then it will remain in its deformed condition. That is called as plasticity. Ductility, it is the ability of material to be drawn into wire with the application of tensile forces. Steel, copper, aluminium, nickel, zinc, lead and tin are good ductility materials or are having good ductility properties. Brittleness is the property of material opposite to ductility. That means it will not be forming or will be able to deform and reshape itself into wire or sheet, but it will break up. It is the property of breaking of material with a little permanent distortion or deformation. Cast iron is a brittle material. Example, cast iron is a brittle material. Malleability, it is a special case of ductility which permits material to be rolled or hammered into thin sheets. Lead, soft steel, wrought iron, copper and aluminium are the example of materials having good malleability. Toughness. What is the property? Toughness. Property of material to resist fracture, that means breakage, due to high impact load. strength only load, it is not an impact load, it is a gradual load, whereas toughness, it is an impact load resistance. Machinability, it is the property of material which refers to relative case which e material can cut. Relative case nahi, ahiya ease vachvano, EASE, ease, like easily machining thai shake eva material. Resilience, it is the property of material to absorb energy and resist the shock and impact load. It is related to toughness, right? Creep, when a part is subjected to constant stress at high temperature. What is the important parameter over here? High temperature. Stress plus high temperature and for a long time, then if it goes into slow permanent deformation, it is called as creep. And creep is not a good property. It is non-required property, but every material creeps. Therefore, creep resistance is the required property. Fatigue, when a material is subjected to repetitive stresses, it fails at a stress below the yield point stress. Such a failure is called as fatigue failure. Right? If you want to have an example, suppose we have a small wire and we want to break it. We don't have cutter. So what we do? We try to fold it number of times in one direction and again repeat it in another direction. And so after few folds, the material breaks, wire breaks. This you can do it. You must have done it somewhere, sometime in your working conditions. Hardness, it is the resistance to wear, scratching, deformation and machinability. Hard materials are difficult to machine. They don't deform easily. They show scratch proofness. That is, we cannot make a scratch on hard material easily. Wear resistance is very good. It also has a mean ability of material to cut another one. Right. Now we have seen different properties, engineering properties of materials. Now many of these properties are good properties or desirable properties, and some of the properties are non-desirable. So whenever we say desirable and non-desirable, the thing is the desirable properties should be present. Non-desirable properties should not be present, or if they are present, it should be in very small number, less number, right? So now we go into further detail how engineering material selection is done. Okay, the process of material selection, where do we get the idea? Where do we get the description or specification as to what type of material is required? We get that from, the process starts from designing. Suppose we want to have a rope to tie up certain boxes, and then those boxes are to be again tied up on some vehicle like our Zomato bag. So Zomato or e-cart, Flipkart people who are delivering, they are having bag belted to their self and on the back of the vehicle also. Now you think of, if those belts are not having good strength, what will happen? Your food will not reach you, your home. It will break and fall down and get damaged in the transit. Because of the road problems, because of the bumps, or because of any jerks that are experienced during the motion of vehicle. So this is the simple example. Now another example I'll give. We get screwdrivers at the cost of say 100 rupees in certain smaller markets, or if you ask for cheaper screwdrivers, they give you cheaper at 20 rupees. When you start using that screwdriver. That is 20 rupees cost screwdriver, and you tighten the screw. After some time, you notice that the point or flake of the screwdriver has broken or it is getting deformed. So this is the problem with the material. So material is not good. So you are not getting the outcome of the application. What is the outcome of application of the screwdriver? To tighten the screws and to unlock the screws. But if the material is not proper, your screw will neither get tightened nor it will get opened up, unlocked, right? Similarly, one more example of such material is if you have a soap and you try to make a scratch with your nail, it will get scratched easily, right? You can make a mark through your nail or even using a pin. You can draw something, you can remove the soap material, you can make the hole, you can puncture it, and so on. Similarly, if you are using a plastic pin to make a puncture in the soap, the pin will break. So when I talk of pin, easily your mind recognizes the pin is always made of steel. But if I say the pin is made of plastic, then it will not be able to pierce in, not be able to get punched into it. And so this is the problem with material selection. Okay, if you have a proper application, if you know what is the use of material, if you know what are the forces, if you know what is the environment where this material is going to be used, these data becomes your reference data. For example, you are buying a mobile phone and some company gives you a condition that my mobile phone is water resistant. Even if it falls in a bucket of water, it won't get damaged. And another company does not provide such property. You will always try to go for water resistance. Although you are not going to use mobile phone underwater, but still, as a safety precaution, you will definitely look at it that in case my mobile falls in water sometime, it should not get damaged. So this is the auxiliary function. So there are, when you are talking of design, the design has two different functions. One is the main function or primary application functions, and another is auxiliary or safety function. So whenever a designer starts thinking of a product, he needs the basic drawing from design. Then second, he needs to select the proper material so that once the product is made, it can work and give good results. Okay, selection according to different parameters, such as what are the different primary parameters that we think of? What is the mechanical load? What is the wear? How much electrical insulation or thermal insulation is required? And whether it will be available in the market at a competitive cost. Okay, so this includes selection of proper manufacturing process. Secondly, after selection of this material, we have to think of how it is to be manufactured. We select the best material, but then we don't have a manufacturing method to process the material and make it into shape and size of the required product. So that is also required to be considered. So proper manufacturing process are to be selected, proper choice, that is selecting of substitute or alternative materials when needed. So if there are 8 properties you are looking for, you can have A material. With 7 properties justified, you can have B material. And if the 8th property that was neglected or eliminated is not of very high importance, then you have to compare material A and material B cost wise and in the reference of manufacturing process condition. If material B is more suitable, less costly, we generally go for material B, or else we go for material A. Contributing and evaluating material test results. So once you make the product, you have to check the characteristics and test results of the material that you have selected for the product. Studying and composing material data before placing the order. So these are the steps for material selection and ordering the material. One of the most challenging tasks of material engineer is the proper selection of material for a particular job. Example, a particular component of a machine or structure. Right? Because if you select a component of the machine and the component fails, that means your machine is not usable. The material may be good, machine may be very good, but one component fails. So at the point when one component fails, your machine itself stops working. So that is a big loss. An engineer must be in a position to choose the optimum combination of properties in material at the lowest possible cost, compromising the quality. That is, without compromising the quality. That means quality of the product should not go down, but you should make an ideal choice. So various factors that we have discussed are called as factors affecting selection of materials. First is component shape, dimensional tolerance, mechanical properties, fabrication, that is manufacturing requirements, service requirements, that means after product is manufactured, what are the problems and solutions that you can provide, cost of processing, cost of material and cost of processing. Cost of processing is related with cost of manufacturing and fabrication. And again, everything said and done, the material should be available in market. Otherwise, you will specify such a good material and it will not be available in market. Again, selection of an appropriate material and its subsequent conversion into a useful product with desired shape and properties can be a rather complex process. Nearly every engineered item goes through the sequence of activities that include material selection, process of production, evaluation means checking and testing, and whether redesign is possible. If redesign is possible, again you redesign it, again go for selection. So this cycle keeps on repeating to improve the quality of product, right? Now we go into engineering classification or designation of standard materials. So designation of standard materials is American Society for Testing of Materials, that is ASTM designation system, wherein metals consist of letter A for ferrous materials, followed by the arbitrary sequential number. Arbitrary sequential means any 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay? And it is a sequential, means if first material is identified, it will have number 1 and so on. So there are hundreds and thousands of materials and they are given number 1 to end of the number. Whenever this ASTM standard follows the metric units, then it is given the number or letter suffix as M. ASTM 458M or 548M means the units of the properties in this standard are using metric standards, means SI units. Example of ASTM ferrous designation system. Think this was done properly. So ASTM A582/A582M-95B2000 grade 303 SE-free-machining stainless steel bars. What does this indicate? The bottom part A describes ferrous material, 582 is the sequential number, M indicates the standard uses SI unit or metric unit as the units of different properties of the material. 95 indicates the year of adoption, that is pella sauthi pella a kyare lidu. In 95 ma a material approved karyu ASTM, and 2000 in bracket indicates the last
reapproval or revision in the standard material. Then it has written grade 300 SE, indicates grade of the steel. In this case, it is a selenium addition free machining steel bars, stainless steel bars. So such breakup of material should be known to you whenever you are talking of a standard material. Okay, so such things may be asked in your assignment, online
assignments that we are giving to you. So you must remember such, not only one material, some other material may also be given, and you have to give the information what A stands for, what is 582, what is M, what is 95, what is 2000, or so on. Grade is used to describe chemical composition. Now, what is grade, meaning of grade? It is used for describing chemical composition. Type is used to define the deoxidation practice in manufacture of this particular material. Class is used to indicate other characteristics such as strength or surface finish. Example, ASTM A106-02A. Grade A, grade B, and grade C. So there are three different grades of this material, grade A, grade B, and grade C. And depending on the carbon content, this grade A, B, and C are classified. Typically, there is increase in amount of carbon and the tensile strength as starting from A to C. Next group type of designation of material is SAE, stands for Society of Automotive Engineers, American Institute of Standards, that is AISI. And the classification is, it gives designation of chemical composition of carbon and alloys. The first letter 1 of the designation indicate carbon steel. So it has a 4-digit number. The first letter is for carbon, that is 1, that is the main alloying element. Carbon steel comprises of 1XXX groups in the SAE AISI system and are subdivided into 4 categories due to variance in certain fundamental properties. Similarly, 2 is for nickel steels, 3 is for nickel chromium steels, 4 is for moly steels, 5 for chromium steels, 6 for chromium vanadium steels, 7 for tungsten chromium steels, and 9 for silicon manganese steels. If you see the photograph on right hand side, you will get XX type of material selected and second XX amount of carbon present in the steel, right? Again, here the number, if it is 20, what does this indicate? Percentage of carbon is 100 times. So actually 20% carbon is not there, 0.2% carbon is there. Okay, 20 divided by 100. Percentage of major alloying element. If it has some alloying element, it will be shown by second X. Okay. You may get such diagram and you may be asked to indicate what is this 2X and what is this X and what does this indicate, right? Options will be given to you. You have to identify the correct option. You see, you can remember or write down such tables and keep it with you, so that 10, that is plain carbon steel, 1% maximum. 11, sulfurized free machining steel. 12, the ferrodized free machining steel. 15, plain carbon with manganese, 1%, that is main alloying element, and so on. Okay, so you must remember this. You see, here you are getting manganese 1211, nickel 2. In previous slide, if you see, what is 2? Nickel steels. 3, nickel chromium. Okay, so you see over here, nickel steels, nickel chromium steels, moly steels. Then 4 is for chromium moly, then nickel moly steels 4 again, and chromium steels 5. Chromium may be up to what percent? 0.27 to 65%. Chromium may be 1.5 to 1% carbon maximum. Okay, such things are there, and you must remember this chart. Now coming to cast irons. What are cast irons? They are the material that contain carbon to the order of 1.7% to 4.5% maximum. It also contains small amount of silicon, manganese, phosphorus and sulfur. What are the properties of cast iron? It is brittle material, it is low cost material, good casting characteristics, high compressive strength, wear resistance is good, excellent machinability, tensile strength ranges from 100 to 200 MPa, compressive strength is 400 to 1000 MPa, shear strength is 120 or 120 MPa. This is you must remember. So this is a typical gray cast iron. Cast irons are again classified into two types. One is called as gray cast iron and another is called as white cast iron. Okay, so you have gray cast iron and white cast iron. These are the two types of cast irons that we have. Again, you have phosphorus. So, phosphorus, sulfur and iron. Components made of gray cast iron: machine tool bodies, automotive cylinders, housing, flywheels, pipes and fittings, and agriculture implements. So, you must remember these applications. Gray cast iron, the Indian standard is 210, which was first implemented in 1993 and gradually it is revised. So, what is the number? Say, it is given as FG. 120 means that it is a gray cast iron with 120 MPa of minimum strength. This is the minimum strength. Okay. And if hardness is required, then we have again something over here which is added to it, Fg 120 plus something, then you can get the hardness also. For example, you see Fg 150, Fg 200 to Fg 400. These are the seven classes of gray cast iron with increasing order of tensile strength, as well as increasing order of hardness. Okay. White cast iron, carbon content is 1.7475 to 2.3. What was the carbon content over here? 3 to 3.5. This is the main difference. Silicon, sulfur, phosphorus, you can read out. White, it is white in color, that is shiny. Carbon is present in the form of cementite. In gray cast iron, carbon is present in the form of graphite. Right? This is what you have to remember. Combined, you see, free carbon or graphite and combined carbon or cementite. So, free carbon or graphite means gray cast iron, and combined carbon or cementite means white cast iron. These are very hard materials, cannot be machined with ordinary cutting tools. It has very high tensile strength, very low compressive strength. This is the important difference. So you should be able to distinguish between these two. Components, car wheels. This car means railway car wheels. Rolls for crushing the grains and jaws for crusher plates. And next is alloyed cast iron, or it is called as mottled cast iron. What are the properties? It is alloyed by using alloying elements like nickel, chromium, moly, copper and manganese in sufficient quantities. Alloying element give more strength and results in improvement of properties.
what is increased? Strength, wear resistance, corrosion resistance, or heat resistance. Okay, so what are the different components that are used made from mottled cast iron? This is the list of components you should remember. If there is a match the column type of question, some from this, some from other would be there, and you should be able to identify what is the type of cast iron used for making these products. Okay, so we'll stop over here today. Few more slides are there, but time is limited. So next time I'll continue from this point, and we will finish the first chapter in next lecture on Monday. Your timetable has again changed, so I'll revise the scheduling of the lectures. The lecture for division 1 and 2, both lectures are two lectures on Monday and two lectures on Saturday. So I'll just revise the schedule. You can have a look and you will get notification and attend accordingly. You see, your division 1 lecture is on Monday 11:30 to 12:30, and division 2 MT lecture is on Monday 2 to 3 p.m. and rest we have it on Saturday, as today you have, right? So I'm just putting this to your notice. You must check the notification that you will get, the revised notification. So you have MT lecture on Monday and Saturday for both the divisions. Okay, I hope this has cleared most of the points. Balance things, we will continue on Monday. Thank you.